Morning.
Morning.
The Old Testament lesson this morning is from Genesis chapter 2, 32, verses 22 to 31. Jacob wrestles at the Nile. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." And Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jesus asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. The epistle lesson is from 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verse 14 through chapter 4, verse 5. And it's the parable of the widow and the unjust judge. I'm ahead of myself. It's 2 Timothy, let's find itself. 3:14. And it's Paul's charge to Timothy. "But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that you are able to instruct, that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message, be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable, convince, rebuke, and encourage with the utmost patience in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. As for you, always be sober, enduring suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully." Now, Luke chapter 18, the parable of the widow and the unjust judge. "Then Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for the people. In that city there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, 'Grant me justice against my opponent.' For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, 'Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this woman and widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In today's world, we cannot listen or read the news without being bombarded with stories that incite anxiety and fear. We live in the fear of the threats of another attack on our soil like 9/11, mass shootings close to home, disease that could strike us at any minute, increasing crime, senseless acts of racism, and so many ways that let fear pervade our lives. A few weeks ago, my daughter came home looking visibly upset. She said to me, hesitation in her voice, "Mom, I got in trouble at school today. To tell you the truth, I got in trouble yesterday too." I was puzzled because she doesn't usually get in trouble, so I asked her, "What for?" She proceeded to explain to me, "Mom, I got in trouble because I was hugging my friend, and I didn't listen to getting in trouble yesterday, and I did it again today, and so I got in trouble again." Now I'm really confused, and I asked her, "Why would you get in trouble for hugging your friend?" She explained to me that there's this new school rule. It's called the no-touch rule. No handshakes, no hugs, no touching of any kind. In fact, when they're on the playground and they want to play tag, they have to use two fingers and touch the back only. Which is pretty interesting because I'd like to see how that works out. As my daughter explains it, you never feel your big tag. This was my first introduction to this apparently ever-growing rule. I reassured her that she was not going to be in trouble at home because of this little mishap at school. In fact, I let her know that I was happy that she stuck to her values. If any of you get to know my daughter a little more, you'll know that love is not everything that she is. But this new zero tolerance rule caused my daughter to get in trouble for hugging her friend. Disturbed by this, I did a little research, because that's what I do every time I get disturbed. Good old Google, right? Well, there's a reason why this rule is in place. Many urban schools are enacting this rule. One school in Virginia explains why they enacted this rule. That certain handshakes, hugs, or gestures in some way display a gang affiliation. Which means the other rival gangs see this affiliation and it eventually leads to fighting. About a year ago, Amy, a professor friend of mine, also told me about an educational training that she went to for her college. She there explained to me that they were also told that they were no longer to touch the students in any way. Why? Because this was the best way to prevent sexual misconduct lawsuits. She was deeply disturbed by this, and like myself, she researched. She found several studies that suggested that this was not a good thing. She was disturbed by the ramifications of this rule. She realized through these studies that positive touch, a hand on the back while you're speaking to a student, led to increasing academic performance and positive emotions for the students. It's easy to do this search again today and find these studies that suggest that this is a good thing. Yet despite all of this science, this rule continues to grow in popularity. Schools are implementing a rule that is driven, deeply driven by fear. And as a result, schools are punishing good students, possibly good citizens. And in my opinion, this goes against the root and the design of our school system, which is to create good and respectable citizens and contributing members of our society. Kylie and Amy's Christian values shouldn't have to be compromised because of a fear-driven rule. Nobody's values should have to be compromised because of these fears. But fear-driven responses like this continue to be around us. There's a man who's driven by fear who compromises his ethical values by fudging a few numbers on the ledger because his boss told him to do so because he was afraid of unemployment. The police officer, driven by fear, who commits a violent act of crime against the person they are to protect. The father, who out of desperation steals food because he's afraid his family will starve. The country, who driven by fear allows innocent people to be detained innumerably. Good people who neglect helping a poor person because they are afraid they may be harmed by them. Today's Bible Old Testament lesson is about Jacob, who acts out of fear. Now, Jacob is not everyone's favorite character in the Bible, because even when he begins, he's gripping at the heel of his brother being born, and shortly thereafter, he steals his brother's birthright. He uses trickery to steal his father's blessing, and driven by fear after doing so, he runs and flees to his family to escape retribution. Again, he tricks his family into gaining prosperity. And when he's faced with this problem, this fear that his family might seek retribution, he again runs and flees. And that's shortly right before where we find our text pick up. Science tells us that fear occurs in the amygdala, the reptilian part of our brain. In this fear mode, people react in two ways: by fight or flight. Or by avoiding the problem or devising a plan to resolve the problem. It would be no surprise if Jacob responded to the messenger's report that Esau is coming with 400 men by fleeing like he's done in the past. But I think in this case, he's got nowhere to flee to. After all, he burned that bridge and he burned that bridge. So he does what the schools are doing, and he responds to his fear by devising a plan. A plan in this case to separate his family into two companies, believing that some will be harmed, maybe even killed, but at the cost of the whole, saving those ones that he likes a little more. Basically saying some lives are better than others. Finally, his plan's in place, he's ready to move forward, but fear, again, begins to stir inside of him. So he begins what I would suggest is the beginning of wrestling with God. It comes a little bit before our passage. He returns to God and says, "Deliver me, please, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I am afraid of him. He may come and kill us all." The Hebrew verb here that is used is vayira, which in this case tense can literally be translated as exceedingly fearful. Here he is saying and pleading with God, "Please, please deliver me, because I am so afraid he will kill all of us." He continues to go on wrestling with this fear with God by saying, "O God of my father Abraham and God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, 'Return to your country and to your kindred, and I will do you good,' I am not worthy of the least of all this steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown to your servant. For with only my staff I crossed this Jordan." He does what many Presbyterian churches do and what this church does so often every week in worship. He confesses his sins. And then later on, he goes on through intercessory prayer, requesting that God do good for him and for others. He continues again to wrestle with this fear out with God as he says, "Yet you have said, I will surely do you good and make your offspring as the sand of the sea, which cannot be counted because of their number." You see, here he sort of gives God a little jab. "You know, God, you did make this promise that time ago, and you are God, so you have to keep your promise, so now you have to help me." But it just doesn't end there. The story goes on revealing that he begins wrestling with God over these fears. But as soon as that's over, what does he do? He reverts back to his plan. I don't know about you, but this parallels my life. There's many times where I turn to God to wrestle those fears that I'm struggling with. I go back to life, and just like that, I forgot that I had put it in the hands of God and to trust in God's plan. But again, the story doesn't end. It picks up where we pick up today's scripture. Jacob's fears again begin to get the best of him. He's spending the night in a camp that was staying behind. And we can believe that he couldn't sleep because it says he got up. He got up and he sent his children and his wives and all of his stuff across the Jabbok, and he remained alone. It is at this point that Jacob must again wrestle this fear with God, but at this time a little more literally. Jacob is said to be wrestling with a man who is later identified as God. He is so fired up from fear and adrenaline that he wrestles with God all night long. Until at almost daybreak, it says, God says, "Let me go." It's important that this occurs at daybreak. And I think it's because Jacob knows that if this man, who he believes to be God, sees him, he could be struck dead. You see, in Bible times, if you saw God physically, you would be struck dead. But throughout the night, you would only see this image. You wouldn't see God. Now he's got God right where he wants him. So what does Jacob do? He demands a blessing from God. You see, he thought the resolve to this fear that he had was God's blessing. He's on some right path now. He's figured out some things, but he's still got a ways to go. Why is this blessing so important to Jacob? After all, we recall he tricked his father into giving him his brother's blessing. Well, the Baker's Theological Dictionary explains this importance. The first, a blessing was a public declaration of a favored status with God. Second, the blessing endowed power for prosperity and success. In all cases, the blessing served as a guide and motivation to pursue a course of life within the blessing. Jacob realizes that he must wrestle his fears out with God and then accept God's blessing, truly believing that God's plans will prevail despite all of his failures. As Christians, we are called to act in ways that display our moral values, to stand up against injustice, to be peacemakers, to experience community with one another, and most importantly, to love everyone. The example given by Jacob reminds us that when we face fears, we need not to devise a plan or flee by avoiding the situation altogether. Instead, we need to wrestle those fears with God, then accept God's blessing because ultimately God's plans prevail. If we read further beyond our passage, Jacob's future was revealed, and it is clear God's plans did prevail. Unfortunately, in our lives, we can't always see the future to see the outcome, making it easier to trust in God's plan. But through this passage and through Jacob's example, we know that by working out our fear prayers and wrestling them with God, and we can be reminded that we can trust in God's plans, because God's plans always prevail. God's plans always prevail. Do you have that? Always prevail. We don't need to compromise our values because God's plans always prevail. There's no reason to tolerate injustice in the world because God's plans always prevail. There's no reason to let mass shootings control our behaviors because God's plans always prevail. There's no reason to let fear guide us in making decisions that exclude homosexuals, Muslims, races of any kind, or any stereotyped group, because God's plans always prevail. There's no reason to let fear invade us and resist changes that our churches may be going through. Why? Because God's plans always prevail. There is no reason to let fear control any of our decisions because God's plans always prevail. For the sake of the gospel, for the sake of the world. Amen.